Bandwidth for this podcast is brought to you by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
Welcome back to MacBreak Studio. We're here in the studio in Digital Barn in Prescott, Arizona. You know, it doesn't matter, it's a green screen, who cares,
right? We could be anywhere.
So we're going to be talking about the new features in Final Cut Pro 10.1.2, specifically media management, major changes there. Yeah. So Mark's going to walk us through the essentially key three changes, right?
Yeah, sort of three. There's a lot of to talk about. There's a lot of changes in 10.1.2, and over the next few MacBreak Studios, we're going to be diving into various features, but the biggest thing really relates to media management. And you might say, well, wait a minute. Didn't media management just change in 10.1?
They're refining it.
They are. So we introduced the library model, which is fantastic. But there are some changes here that are very interesting, and I think they are good refinements. You know, Apple keeps tweaking, make things a little better. So the first thing I want to talk about is they've changed the way that you establish the import options for a library.
You say change like in big changes or?
Well, let me just show you. I think the easiest thing is to show you. So what I'm going to do, I'm here in Final Cut. I'm going to create a new library. I have one open, but I'm just going to create a new one to see what happens. So I'm going to say new library, and I'm just going to call it MBS.
For MacBreak Studio.
And then MM for media management. So this is my little library. I'm just going to save it in a folder here. You know, as usual, you can save libraries wherever you want. As soon as I save it, notice something. The inspector popped open.
A little window that wasn't there before is now there.
Yeah, and it's the inspector. And it's, you know, if I can click it to open and close it, it is the inspector. But it popped open by itself as soon as you create a library. And there's a whole new pane here called library properties. So this whole pane is new. And it establishes for you exactly what's going on with storage locations for everything. Yeah, so let's overview it here. At the very top is the name of your library and the name of the drive that it's located on. So right away, you know where it's located. In fact, if you move your mouse over it, the tooltip will give you more information about that library. Not much, just the name of the library, but the tooltip will come in more handy later here. Underneath it here, we have storage locations. So check this out. It's broken into three primary locations here. We've got media, cache, and backups, okay? So media means the media that you're going to bring into your library.
So anything you import, video, still images, photos,
graphics, clips, anything
constitutes media.
Yeah, anything that you're going to import, that tells you right here where it's going to go. And by default, it's going to go in the library, which if you've already been using Final Cut Pro 10.1 or you've been watching our tutorials, you know that that is called
a managed library.
A managed library, right. All the media that you import will be copied into the library. The second thing is called the cache. And the cache is the repository for
your bank account.
Your bank account, your cache, right? C-A-C-H-E. And the cache is where you have all your render files are stored. Right. All your analysis files, optical flow, stabilization, thumbnails.
Waveforms.
All of those things.
Constitute cache.
Cache. And they're stored by default in the library as well. And then finally, where your backups are stored, which by default is this Final Cut Backups folder in your movies folder.
So it's a local drive.
It's a local drive. In fact, if you do move the cursor, there's your tooltip. If you move the cursor over each of these, it'll tell you the exact path of the library.
No, it's actually showing you the path of your media there, isn't it?
Well, here it's showing the path of this library. Oh, so you see MMFCP bundle. So it's showing the path of the actual library. And down here is media locations, but we don't have any media yet. Okay, there's nothing in here yet. So this shows you where things are going to be stored by default and allows you to change it. Okay, so that's the first change, and we'll work with it in just a minute. But the second change is that you can now take any transcoded media, meaning optimized media or proxy media, and you can store it wherever you want.
Wait, okay, so previously, to this version, all the proxy and transcoded had to be stored in the library.
No matter what, it was inside
the
library.
So the library can get huge, even right. If your original media is somewhere else.
Even if you chose to store your media somewhere else or leave it in place.
Right. That's a pretty big change.
It's a big change, and the key benefit to that is if you are storing your media externally, then it allows you to have a very, very small library.
Library can be very tiny that you can pass back and forth.
Yeah, because it's just pointing to the media. And so if you are in a shared environment, either locally or remote, you can pass this small library back and forth and people can access, it'll point to the media. So I want to demonstrate exactly what that happens. In fact, if you look very close, it's very tiny here, but you look, media includes imported files, proxy and optimized files, and consolidated files. Okay, so I want to demonstrate how it actually can include that proxy and optimized media when it's not in the library. So how do you change this? That's what this modify settings button is about, and it allows you to change these targets. So if I click on it, we get a window that lists these same three areas, media, cache, and backups. Okay, and so what I'm gonna do for media, I'm gonna go to choose, and I'm gonna place the media instead. I'll just place it in this same folder I have here, and I'll create a new folder, and I'll call it my media.
And this could be folder, could be just anywhere.
Anywhere, right.
You're creating an external folder for your media outside the library.
Yeah, so, and you might wanna do this, I mean, our general recommendation is use a managed library if you're a solo editor, but if you're going to need to share your project with other editors, you probably want your media external.
That's right.
So I'm targeting a store location. Off, you might want to put on a separate drive, a RAID or what have you. So I'm gonna do that. I'm not gonna change anything else for now. I'm gonna say okay. And we can see that we've now targeted this external
folder.
Right. So now if I go to import a clip, let me select the event here. And if I go to import a clip into this event, I'll go to the desktop on this drive here, and I have a clips folder. And here I have a clip. And what I'll do, I'll choose to import. And here we'll see the natural consequence of the fact that we now decide where the import happens up front. Okay, and that consequence is we can no longer make that decision here.
Right, where previously you could actually do in library, out of library, right here in this window, but no longer.
Exactly, every time you imported, you had to think, okay, am I going inside the library, outside the library? No longer, now we can see the files are targeted, copy to library storage location, my media.
Now, if you didn't target an external folder like you did, it would just say copy to library.
Copy to library, right. So this is fixed to whatever you set in the library properties.
Got it.
So that's a pretty big difference. You always still have this option down here, leave in place. Even if you are internal or external, you can always leave media where it is. And that can be a little bit confusing, so I'm just gonna say right now, like, we go into much more depth on this whole thing in our media management tutorial.
That's right.
So I would advise checking that out. In fact, the whole first lesson is free, and it goes into great deal into this. But right now, I'm just gonna copy that clip to my storage location, so I'll click import. Actually, I didn't transcode the media, but it's okay because I can do it after the fact. I wanted to check the transcode media checkbox there, so I'm going to do it after the fact, transcode media, and I'll choose to create proxy media for this one. I'll click OK, and we'll see down in the progress dialog here.
The background tasks window. So it's basically copying the clip to that external folder, and at the same time, it's gonna be generating proxy media for that clip. And
exactly.
All of it will be in that external folder.
Exactly. Okay, so now it's done copying the clip and transcoding the media. So if I right click on this clip and choose to reveal in Finder, where we are taken to, let me open this up a little wider, is the My Media folder, right? So it put it into that external location. Not only that, here's a Final Cut proxy media folder, and there's our proxy, okay? So it put the proxy in that same external location instead of inside the library. And that's huge, that's a big change.
It is. I noticed there's a date stamp on each folder for the media.
Yes, it puts it in a folder with a date stamp based on the creation date for that clip. And that's we'll actually talk more about that in another MacBreak Studio because there's no renaming the file. So it has some organizational structure that's doing that. The third thing I want to mention is related to media management is if you've created optimized and proxy media in previous versions of Final Cut, you couldn't delete that transcoded media without going into the package. Going into the bundle, you know, right click and go in the bundle.
Right.
Now you can delete transcoded media directly inside Final Cut.
That's fantastic.
Okay, so
it's
a good thing. So I'll select this one I just created, and I'll go, oh, and by the way, actually I'll select this one because it has some more projects and events in it. This works on the project level, the event level, or the whole library level. So if you select just a project and I go into the file menu, I can choose to delete generated project files, okay? If I select the event, I can choose to delete generated event files. And then if I choose the whole library, I can choose delete generated library files.
That's probably the global one you want for everything
there. Yeah, usually I think it's where you're gonna go. And we've had something similar in previous versions that allowed you to delete render files. So I can check that, and usually I would check, yeah, let's delete them all. Right. I'm trying to free up disk space, or if I'm not trying to free up disk space, if I want to keep the existing render, I could just say unused, but I can choose all. But here, this is the big change. I can choose whether I want to delete optimized or proxy or both right in Final
That's
Cut.
That's nice.
It's great. Great way if you're finished with your optimized or proxy, you don't have no need for them anymore. If you're archiving, fantastic feature there. So just a quick introduction to the sort of high-level changes to how Media Manage changed in 10.1.2.
Right, fantastic changes, especially if you're working with other editors and being able to have all that proxy transcoded outside the library. Yep. And Mark, as Mark mentioned, we have this tutorial that goes through all these different workflow scenarios. You want to check that out. In the meantime, I think we'll look at the next thing in the next lesson, next MacBreak.
Yes.
Make sure to follow us on Twitter, Facebook, and feel free to email us if you have specific questions. I want to thank you for watching another episode of MacBreak Studio. See you next time.